as well as parenting ourselves. I hope you enjoy this week's episode.
Hi, Kat.
Hi, Monique. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm fine, thanks.
Welcome to the podcast.
Thank you so much for having me.
I'm so glad to have you. How are you doing with everything that's going on with the virus? How are you managing? Are you working from home right now?
Yes, I'm lucky enough. Well, I normally see my clients in central London, but I've moved everyone to being online and I'm seeing everyone via Zoom. So I feel really grateful that I can actually do that, that I have a job that allows that.
Yes, yes. Yeah, that's really good. It's good that you can keep also the connection with everyone.
Good. Yes. Yeah.
I'm really exactly. grateful that you're here.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. Yeah. This is a topic that's very close to my heart.
Yes. And mine too. And all, you know, parents who are listening to this podcast, who are parents of children, this is such an important topic because, you know, I've heard it said, and this is for people without trauma, you know, there's no schooling on how to be a parent or how to be a good parent, but imagine those of us who have had childhood trauma and then we're in the role of being a parent ourselves.
It's the hardest job in the world.
It is. And so much of this is that we come into it with the very best intentions. Like, we know what it was like to have, to not have attunement and attention. And we want so much to be there for our children. And yet, we find that we can get triggered and
stuff
can come up. So that's what I'm hoping that we can talk about. I've kind of entitled this from you, actually, Parenting with CPTSD and Reparenting Ourselves.
Okay, great. I think that's a good title. Should I talk a little bit about my story and do a bit of psychoeducation? Do you think that would be useful?
Very much so. I mean, as much psychoeducation as we can get is so helpful, because when we understand, we feel less anxious. So yes, please.
Yes. And I think particularly with trauma, it's so important to know what's going on in our body and to have as much information about our reactions as possible, because then it destigmatizes it and it gives us, because we want to be empowered. Trauma is disempowering. And so I think it's really helpful. I find it helpful. I think you're really right when you said parenting is hard for even the most securely attached, well-adjusted and well-regulated person. And typically when we've had trauma, we are not securely attached. We're not well-regulated. We have a narrow window of tolerance. So our ability to sit with big feelings or boredom and depression and the lower end of the feeling spectrum is also hampered. So we spend quite a lot of time out of our window of tolerance often, which is really uncomfortable, from a bodily perspective. And so when we go into parenting with that, the struggling to regulate ourselves and common trauma adaptations, it can feel, it's very discombobulating, actually, I think. I had always wanted to be a mother. I longed to have children. But also often what happens with, when you have childhood trauma, relationships are a bit of a struggle. And I've sort of personally had to work a lot on finding a loving adult relationship which was actually healthy. So I probably had children quite late in life. I think that the most common trauma adaptations that I see in my practice, which are very widespread in the population, because about roughly 50% of the population are insecurely attached. And that means in some way, and I just want to sort of highlight here that I'm making very broad brushstroke statements about theory and I'm linking stuff. So if you want to have more sort of, if you want to have some recommendations about books, if you want to look into something, just let me know. When we have So common things that happen when we have trauma are that we become very controlling as children. We develop into perfectionists, and we have a very overactive inner critic, and we do a lot of people pleasing. And that typically happens when we don't get our needs met in childhood, because as children, we should always be looked after and be cherished, have our humanness celebrated and all our emotions held. And that's not what happens with trauma. Very common. Okay, let me give you a bit of detail about my story. So
That was so good and so right on, and people could really relate. And that's exactly what happens in childhood trauma. Our needs are not met. We are not celebrated, you know, for who we are. And in fact, that is very often why we turn it inwards, and then we start to think that we are, for lack of a better word, worthless or garbage or stuff like that. So
yes.
Yeah, you really, that's very, very true. Sorry, you want to continue? You wanted to share a bit about your story.
Oh, my story. Oh yeah. And I think you're right about that feeling about not good enough, because every single person who comes through my door to see me as a psychotherapist feels like that. And that's a part of my story. Mm-hmm. And, I had a brother who died when I was 3, and a younger brother. And that had a massive impact on our whole family life. My mother got very depressed after that. There was a lot of addiction in my father's family. And he maybe was always going to become an alcoholic, but that kind of didn't really help, because in those days, this happened kind of in 1979. I don't think there was that much therapy. And I got a deep feeling at that time, which I know because I have some letters about what I used to say to my mother about not feeling, was I not good enough? Because she was always crying. And so that became like a core part of my story, not feeling good enough. And then the sort of shame core develops, where you're constantly doing things to try and layer over that feeling of not being good enough, because perfectionism is at its very base a defense against not being good enough. It's not actually about getting everything right. It's a desperate attempt to hide the shame that you might not be good enough. And it's so widespread in society today. I mean, it's absolutely a scourge. And I think that is a sort of evidence of how much trauma there actually is out there.
I just wanted to pick up on something. So it's very interesting. You are only 3 years old. And so a 3-year old is watching their mom cry. You know, maybe you didn't fully understand brother's gone, mom's crying, but how you internalized that something was wrong. This was, something was wrong with you, and you internalized it that it's yours. And you took on that her crying. And then it's about me, like she's crying because I'm bad, or whatever your little mind concluded.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's very, because I mean, that's kind of in some ways the essence of the parentified child, that we think we are responsible for our parents' emotions, and mm-hmm. that, and children are rightly narcissistic, because we think everything is about us. And if parents don't make an active effort to sort of shift that thinking, then that is kind of what happens.
Yeah.
That's part of what happened for me. And then I think that I just spent a lot of time. I had sort of a lot of anxiety. I had a lot of little rituals. I was quite OCD about cleanliness. I tried to, you know, a lot of rituals, especially OCD stuff, is about control and safety. I did a lot of that stuff. Mm-hmm. And some of that I brought into adulthood with me. Mm-hmm. And all of those things, control, perfectionism, the overactive inner critic, people pleasing, in some way, they're all an attempt to deny our own humanness. And as humans, we're messy. You know, people are messy. We have messy emotions. Mm-hmm. We all are all over the place sometimes. We go up and down in our feelings. Mm-hmm. But when no one holds that for you when you're growing up, essentially kind of regulating you and being you within all those big feelings, you learn to kind of put that all away. Is that making sense?
Oh, totally. Yep.
And so I think I put away a lot of my humanness. And that kind of goes to the point also of regulation, because when we're a child, we have a lot of big, big emotions and we can't contain them. We don't have a sophisticated enough brain. We don't have impulse control. We have, our brain has not matured enough to be able to do that. So we need our parent to act as a self-regulating other for us. And so with, I'm sure your readers know all about regulation, but just briefly, sorry, your listeners, briefly, we initially borrow both our parents' frontal cortex and their nervous system to help us regulate from when we're tiny babies. They do that sort of job of, you know, stroking us or going, oh, sweetie, what's going on with you? Do you need some milk? Do you need a nappy change? You know, are you cold? Are you hot? You know, as a mother, you kind of run through all those things because you don't actually know what's going on, but you use your own brain and then you use your body to calm your baby. You put your baby on you. You do all those sort of things. But when you have a mother who is not attuned and someone who's probably in their own trauma, they can't really do that for us. Mm-hmm. So we land up being not well regulated and with a sense that our attachment figure may not be that safe for us, because sometimes they might be a source of danger mm-hmm. and sometimes they come for us. So there's that sort of inconsistency. And that is typically what leads to insecure attachment. Monica, I'm aware I'm kind of jumping around. Is this making sense to you?
Yes. And if you're jumping around, good. I'm following you everywhere. I don't feel like you're jumping around.
Okay, good.
To me, it's so interesting. And I'm sure the listeners feel the same way. So what you're okay. talking about is really a little bit about attachment and how when we don't have that insecure attachment or someone that can regulate and calm us down and be interested in us, then we have no one to do that for us and we are left on our own without being regulated.
Yes, exactly. So when we don't have a secure attachment, we land up basically not being that well regulated. And the thing about, you know, because when you have a tantrum or when you're crying when you're a five-year-old or you hurt yourself or you've had a fight with your sister or you've had a bad time at school, you need your parents, your mom or your primary caregiver to really be present for you in those emotions and help you decode what's going on mm-hmm. to really connect, to allow you to feel mm-hmm. And to explain kind of what's going on to you, because you don't have that ability when you're a child. And then to kind of help you move into coping strategies and how you might solve it. But all of that has to be done for us. And if we were just either sent to our rooms or smacked or ignored or abused or neglected emotionally, then we can't kind of process stuff. We don't learn how to process. And so often that's when we're an adult, our inner child will come up and have rages or be very distressed, because that's all our uncontained childhood feeling that hasn't been attended to, essentially. And that kind of shows in our lack of regulation. So can you imagine taking that all into motherhood, taking a lack of regulation in your own person into motherhood makes it an absolute nightmare, really, because you know, you have baby, a crying baby who needs you to help her regulate down and to understand what's going on for her. And the state of the baby crying might be so dysregulating for you as the parent that you can't actually manage to do the job of regulating for the baby. Mm-hmm. Do you see what I mean?
Oh yeah, totally. And sure. And it could trigger a lot of stuff for you inside. So what do you do in a situation like that? What can be helpful?
So I think it's really helpful to first notice. So we all have, first of all, we all have different trauma adaptations. We all have different trauma. There's a lot of common things that go on in households. A lot of common patterns that happen if you're the oldest child of an alcoholic father. You know, there's a lot of things that happen in the way in which you grow up and the way in which you present in the world because of the role you've played in your family and the type of emotional abandonment that you've had. But we all have different things that happen to us. And I really want to make the point that trauma is in the eye of the beholder. You know, some people might be less affected or some people might be more affected, and that's all okay. But so, yeah, we all have different adaptations. Some of us might dissociate a lot and, you know, not be in our bodies. Some of us might do a lot of controlling. Some of us might be really people-pleasing or overdoing a lot. I know for me, control and perfectionism were really, really destructive in my early sort of months about motherhood. And they sort of led to me having a bit of a breakdown when my children were about 10 months. And what was helpful was to really notice that all my old coping mechanisms had come up. And I think that's really common. That is what happens when we have a time of stress. Our old coping mechanisms come up. So people actually might notice now in this time of corona that all their old coping mechanisms have come up. Things that you might have worked on a lot might, you know, be flashing up. You might want to do all the old things that you did before you did some work on yourself, basically. And so I noticed that those came up. I think it's really important to name that. And then I had to really notice in my own reactions to my children what was coming up for me. So to try and give myself a little bit of space instead of just reacting, to try and get in touch with actually what was being said internally. And in order to do that, I think we have to have a felt sense of safety in our body. So the treatment for trauma, ultimately you want to start to feel safe. But when we've had trauma and we're not well regulated, it can feel very unsafe being in our bodies because we have all these reactions or maybe we have flashbacks. So I had to really use some grounding tools and stuff that I could do in the moment and also adopt practices that complete the stress response. So on a daily basis, doing things that that do that. So there's a wonderful book called The Burnout Book by Emily Nagoski and her sister, and they list evidence-based ways to complete the stress cycle, the stress response. And having some of that in each day was really helpful to me so that my body, my nervous system calmed. And some of those are physical activity, so any exercise, dancing in the kitchen helps, you know, mindful breathing. Sometimes breathing is tricky for people with CPSD and trauma, though, because it sometimes does trigger panic attacks. Laughter is really helpful. Crying. I'm a big, big fan of crying. I think it's really, I watched a lot of Grey's Anatomy, actually, in my early, because I'd never watched Grey's Anatomy initially. So then there was like loads of seasons to catch up on. And that would always make me cry. And that always gave me a sense of relief and kind of drained your body of all this excess sort of trauma energy.
Yeah, it makes so much sense because for those of us with trauma, oh my gosh, all our what we would do all the time would be we'd feel this huge stuff, but we weren't allowed to express it. And so we took that energy and we just like shoved it back down over and over and over and over again. And so, yeah, the idea that you're explaining about completing it with the moving and jumping and it makes sense.
Yeah. And it's so much about getting it out of our bodies in some way. I love that. One of the most sort of loving, compassionate books I've read about this is that Pete Walker book about, it was called Thriving. Where is it? Somewhere on my desk, but, and he actually talks about, I have always done a lot of stretching, because somehow it felt good in my body. I would like sit down on the floor and stretch my legs out and fold my whole body over them or fold from the waist. And I never knew why that gave me relief. And then when I read his book, he talks about how we can be very inflexible as trauma survivors. And I think that's also mentally we can be inflexible because we weren't taught to have flexibility in our thinking or to welcome in our sort of human messiness.
Yeah, that's
for
right.
For me, that really links. And so stretching kind of loosens us all over, you know, and in our minds. So I think those are really useful. Mm-hmm. In terms of the triggering, I had to do a combination of things. So I had to do more physical activity. I started to do a lot of swimming to help myself. So I needed childcare so that I could have a break away from my kids. Mm-hmm. So then I could do things to calm my nervous system. And I worked on it in therapy to understand what was going on for my inner child. And it very much linked, some of the stuff that went on for me very much linked my own trauma, because one of the messages that came up for me when my kids were, because I've got twins, and I really feel like I need to say that I love them deeply and I'm deeply grateful for them. And it's brought a lot of beauty into my life. And it has been the hardest thing I have ever, ever, ever done. It nearly felt like it was going to destroy me at some point. Wow. And I had a lot of shame about that, like, what was wrong with me? And how could I have wanted children so much and then have found it like that? I found that a difficult thing to, difficult things to kind of reconcile, because they don't seem to be reconcilable, but going into my trauma history really helped me, mm-hmm. Sort of get more clarity around that. And what I kind of realized over a period of time was that some of the stuff was so triggering for me because I was actually trying to parent from my three-year-old place, and obviously a three-year-old doesn't have very sophisticated coping mechanisms, and also employs childlike tools. So the control, the perfectionism, the very active inner critic, those are all childlike ways of being that I developed, maybe you or we developed to survive. I love Janina Fisher and the way she writes about how all of the things that we have, and Gabor Mate also says this, that all of the ways in which we are as adults started initially as a survival tool as a child. So we can't kind of blame our different parts or self states for that, because those parts helped us survive.
Yeah.
And that's really where the self-compassion comes in. I think that we can go, oh dear, look what I'm doing. Oh dear, that's because this, this, and this happened to me. And at that time I really needed to be like that to survive. And now it doesn't help me that much. And I realized that what would come up for me when they're having a tantrum would be, cause I would read all these lovely, like, connecting parenting books about how to really be present for your children. And I really want to do that as a psychotherapist. I know how important it is to be emotionally present, to be able to regulate them, all of those things. But then I sometimes wouldn't be able to do that. Mm-hmm. And so it's a sort of a double-edged sword, because on the one hand, as a trauma survivor, you know what you want to try and be like, but then also as a trauma survivor, you have the control, the perfectionism beating you up endlessly on this other side. So you get it wrong and then you beat yourself up terribly. And there's like no self-compassion. So I found introducing a massive dose of self-compassion really helpful.
And I love that, because really, that's why trauma therapy, coaching is so helpful, because had you not had the understanding of why you had these adaptions, you wouldn't have been able to be self-compassionate to yourself, you know, to see that you did these to survive so that you could live, so that you could continue to be safe. And
exactly.
I think that's really beautiful. And then you could have compassion on yourself when you see yourself struggling. I mean, your heart is, you want to be that parent. You want to be that kind, attuned parent.
Yeah.
Yeah. I hear you.
Yeah. I think there's really, and I'm sure that many of your listeners share that mm-hmm. that we want to be different.
Yes.
To maybe what we received. But some of the coping things that we had as children mm-hmm. make it so hard to do that. And I really had to kind of learn. My sister said something really helpful to me. She said, there's no way to win at this. Because I think also with the perfectionism comes this thing of, I've got to get this absolutely right. And there is no way to get parenting right. It's just, it is a messy business. It's a messy business because of everything. There's so much emotion and, you know, we probably will always be dysregulated at some point by our children because they are dysregulating. And so we can't perfectly attend to their needs all the time. So I had to have a kind of a big dose of humility, a dose of compassion. I had to really get in touch with my inner child and notice what messages were coming up for her. So for me, when they would tantrum, it would be a message would come up for me about, why are you doing this to me? But that was from a younger part of me, that message. And I learned to soothe her and then to notice that my children's emotions are just, they're just telling me things that are going on. And I got much, much better at being present for them and naming for them what was going on, connecting, soothing myself in the moment. So doing breathing, I think breathing to activate your parasympathetic nervous system is I found that really, really helpful for me. So the simplest thing is just to double the length of your exhalation relative to your inhalation, and that activates the parasympathetic branch of your nervous system, of your autonomic nervous system. And so that would help me. Also, something that I always love is putting my hand on my own heart and my other hand on my stomach and just kind of breathing in and connecting to myself, because any small physiological change you make helps you come back into the moment, and then you can more likely get back into your adult state so that you can get on with the job of parenting. And yeah, I think really noticing, once I started to be quite honest as well about things, I found it much more refreshing, because I had a lot of shame about the fact that I struggled. And I think shame...
I love that you use the word messy, because it's very normalizing and it is humanity. That's not the that we get. We're like, this is how to be, and this is how to be, and this is how to act, and that's how to act. But the truth is, like you said, we could be great in one moment and down in another, and great in a moment and down in, and that's messy, and that's humanity. I love it. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And that's what we all like. And with trauma, there's so much that black and white rigid thinking about there is only one right way, and you toiling and toiling as a child to get on the right side of your parents so you can survive, because you need them to survive.
Right.
And trying to introduce those shades of gray and accepting those shades of gray and accepting that one day I'll change my mind about something and that's okay. One day I might be fantastic and one day I might not be that fantastic. Mm-hmm. But accepting responsibility for all of that and then repairing when there is a rupture. You know, sort of taking the adult responsibility, I found to be so helpful. And also not going to that cycle of beating ourselves up, because I notice I can spend ages just self-criticizing, basically. It's like that's almost an addiction all by itself, the addiction to negativity about yourself and beating yourself up. And I had to really work to intercept that. And sometimes I still sort of challenge myself with that. I'm like, this really, are you still trying to do this? This hasn't really worked that well after like 43 years. Why are we still doing this? You know, but I think so many of these behaviors are so sort of ingrained, and it takes time to change behavior. Neither you nor I would have a job if it was so easy to change behavior. Do you know what I mean? We would just read a book and go, oh yeah, okay, great, I'm going to be like that.
But it's interesting, because as you're speaking, I have got a, you know, developmental trauma and from birth. And then, you know, as an adult, I was always, the inner critic was so loud. It's very quiet now.
Like, oh, that's wonderful.
Which just shows that we can heal and we can change. Not perfection, but the inner critic is very quiet. And I think because compassion has come in.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I think that's the greatest gift, the kindness and self-compassion. Yeah. But when we weren't really kind of cherished as children, and I find that word cherish so beautiful, because really as children and babies, we are great gifts, but we didn't learn that about ourselves. So we continually, we kind of taught to abandon ourselves continually. And so trying to refocus back on yourself so that you don't abandon yourself, it's just such a job, but it is. You're right. I'm so happy to. I'm not sure that my inner critic is as silent as yours yet, but
I'm older than you.
Okay. But I think that healing and kind of being honest about things and breaking through shame has been such a beautiful experience. I would never, ever, ever, ever have wished for the things that have happened in my life. But I feel like it's led me to living a life of much more beautiful authenticity now. Mm. And even though I still go up and down and have like self-doubt and, you know, lots of issues, nothing, but I've come to see that as more that is actually the human condition.
It is the human condition. Yeah.
Because I think also with you just don't learn that. I sort of, there was so much perfectionism and inflexibility. I don't think I actually learned that the whole of life would contain problems. I thought I just had to work harder and be like more good and try harder and get things more perfect. And then I could out-perfect everything.
Right.
That's not the case.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's certainly not the case with motherhood.
And I think I thought that too. But again, because we grew up in chaos, we desperately, desperately want, give me the rules and I'll follow them. Give me the.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So it's predictable. So I get that. You know, it's interesting because I definitely did not feel loved and cherished or anything like that. And I, like you, am a mom of twins. And I can remember when my little girls, I would always do this because it just was natural because I didn't have it. But it's like, every time I would see them, I would make this face as if I saw them for the first time, like I was excited, like, and the eyes speak. And I was just hoping that that message of my eyes like that would get sunk into their heart and they would never forget it, because we know, you know, I don't know. You talked about, I think you said tenderness or whatever word you used, cherish. That's the word. That's it. You know, we want the kids just to know that they're cherished just for who they are.
Yes.
They're breathing.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. And it's hard as well because should I just say one more thing and then we can, if you want to finish up, but I am, you know, I think part of trauma as well is that you have to, well, in my family, like success or marks were rewarded. And that was what was considered really important. And I have to really notice, my children are only little now, they don't go to school yet, but I know that I'm going to have to work hard on a continuous basis to not project stuff onto them mm-hmm. and to not believe that things that I were enforced on me are important, to really just let them be them. They're not little versions of me. anyway, so yeah, do you think we've said enough, Monique? Do you think that'll be useful?
It'll be very useful, but I could talk to you for another 2 hours and I'm sure people could really enjoy listening to you. So maybe we'll have you on again and we'll think of another topic.
Lovely.
There's
that would be a privilege.
Kath. thank you so much for being here. It was such a pleasure. And I'm sure that it will be helpful for everyone. Now tell us, if people want to get in touch with you or follow you, how can they reach you?
So I am psychotherapy_mum on Instagram. And they can message me or follow or say hi. And thanks for having me on. It's been a great privilege. It feels I'm like on a mission to break down shame because there's nothing wrong with any of us.
That's right. There's everything right with us.
Yeah.
All right. So
thank you so much for having me. You too.
Pleasure. Bye-bye.
Okay.
If you would like to find out more information with regards to my coaching options, you could reach me on my website at www.cbtsdcoach.com. You can visit me on my Facebook and Instagram page at cbtsdcoach.